Everybody say amen. God has spoken.
So let the church, say. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to you who are watching via YouTube, and especially to all the participants in this evening's discussions will be on the theme, Rites and Rituals. And now, Dr. Frederica Fairclough will be coming to lead us in the opening prayer.
We praise you, we worship, and we adore you. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have to fellowship like this. And as we come into your presence with thanksgiving and with praise, we ask that you will draw nigh unto us. We pause even now, Lord, to present to you the conversation we'll have this afternoon. We pray for our panelists. We pray, dear Father, that you would speak through them to us. And at the end of today, our hearts will be blessed. And we'll leave here rejoicing, knowing, O God, that we have met with you. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers, we pray. In your Son's name, amen.
Thank you, Dr. Fairclough. And continuing in this theme of the Lord speaking to us and through us will be a ministry team, music ministry team from Tarrant Baptist Church, Mrs. Lori Burnett and her husband, Mr. Livingston Burnett. They're going to be doing for us, Speak, O Lord.
Plans for us.
Thank you so much, Sister Lori and Brother Livingston, for that powerful prayer in song that is so relevant to these times. And they're going to take us now into the introduction to the members of our panel. We have, first and foremost, I'm going to be introducing the men, because even as we are recording this, today is International Men's Day, and so we're bigging up the men today. So I'm starting with the men. And closest to me is Reverend Dwight Fraser, and he's from the Eltham Angel Circuit, which is in St. Catherine. Next to him is Reverend Derrick Sadler from Stokes Hall Circuit in St. Thomas, and then the lady, Reverend Stacey Lalor Knowles, who is from Longville Park in Clarendon. We're going to be hearing some vox pop questions posed to members of the Hanover Street Baptist Church. We asked them, what are you thinking about how communion has been impacted by this COVID-19? Has there been any change? So let's listen to them.
In responding to the question, we want to emphasize that the number of worshipers and their location away from the sanctuary are not factors which can rob the experience of the Holy Communion of its value. The mystery and value are independent variables which are brought to the experience because of the uniqueness of the Holy Communion. These features are intricately linked to the experience and are part of its very nature, irrespective of location.
The value is not lost, and the mystery remains. During the pandemic, there are members who were unable to physically attend worship in the sanctuary. However, they joined with the church from the virtual space. These brothers and sisters were encouraged by the officiating minister to prepare the emblems and to partake of the Holy Communion with those in the sanctuary. And they have reported that the value has not been lost. Remember too, that Holy Communion has always been administered to the homebound, and that has not affected the value and the mystery. So, once you are a child of God and you understand the significance of the Holy Communion, the number of persons gathered and the space, whether it is physical or in the virtual space, has nothing to do with the value and the mystery of the Holy Communion.
So now we're going to go into this first segment of the panel discussion. I'm going to start with a question that I'm going to pose to the three of you, which I'd like you to speak to briefly, please, discussing rites and rituals. What are they to you? What are they to the church? Starting with you, my brother.
So rituals begin, perhaps our understanding should begin with the fact that rituals are a part of daily life. That we have practices in which we engage as human beings that are recurrent and that are meaningful to us. Within the context of the church, it's rituals that enable us to express and engage in the faith experience. And it is rituals that have the official sanction and use of the church that are designated as rites. And what these reflect are experiences of God that are not exhausted in the original moment when they occurred, but as they are re-engaged in the experience of the person of faith, they are occasions for the unleashing and experiencing of the meaning that was engaged in the original encounter. So they have deep spiritual value in terms of how they strengthen and enable and renew faith.
Yes, these rituals of which we, as Baptists, we celebrate the Lord's Supper or the Holy Communion and baptism, they are what help to, they are the mark of the visible church. And they are what we hold on to as sacred. For the rites, like when a baby is born, the baby is dedicated, and they, at a certain age, some people get married. And you know what, at the end of life, we have the funerals. And these are what, you know, these are what, at when this happens, with our people.
Okay, I'm going to say hold that thought, because we're going to get more deeply into it later on. But just very quickly, Reverend Stacey Knowles, could you just tell us your take?
Thank you, Madam Moderator. For me, I believe rites and rituals are terms that we tend to use interchangeably. We speak of rituals, as Rev said, of rituals as habitual practices, things that we do over and over again. And rites speak particularly to certain events that mark a particular moment. And what we find with rites and with rituals is that they bring meaning to the lives and value to the lives of those who participate in them. They help to give us a sense of identity, a sense of solidarity, so that as we participate in these rites and rituals, it tends to draw us not just closer to God, but also closer to each other.
Thank you. Now we're going to go into the discussion of the Lord's Supper, because this is one rite, the sacrament, that is really visibly affected by COVID. How do we conduct the Lord's Supper? Do we conduct the Lord's Supper in such a way that it retains its value, its mystery? How do we deal with people who are homebound? Are we able to serve them? These are some of the questions that I'd like the three of you to consider as you respond now. How do we do communion during the Lord's Supper? I'm going to start with you, Reverend Sam.
Yes, thank you. For the Lord's Supper, as we know, it's a way for the church to look back and at the same time look ahead. The COVID pandemic has affected it, no doubt about that. But we can't afford to not have our communion. And so we're going to have to think of new ways to really get it done. It's a learning curve, meaning some persons will not adjust to it readily. But for example, virtual communion, where you know persons are in their home. But one thing we have to ensure that when we are doing like virtual communion, that it's not taken lightly. That same solidarity and that sacred moment must still be observed when we celebrate communion.
For us at my church, where I serve, the Lord's Supper has been impacted. Perhaps the most visible way is that we now have less persons worshiping, and so there are less persons participating in the Lord's Supper. A number of members have not been able, for one reason or another, to come to service, to participate in service, in worship. And so this has impacted the ways in which are the persons who would normally be receiving the Lord's Supper. What we have tried to do is arrange for the Lord's Supper to be served on more than one Sunday during the month. Traditionally, we would have observed the Lord's Supper on a first Sunday. Now, given the restrictions, the number of persons able to attend by virtue of our space and the various protocols, we find that persons are able to attend, or they choose to attend, only maybe one Sunday for the month. And so we had to make an adjustment to say, instead of just offering or participating on one Sunday, we now have the Lord's Supper available. So on any given Sunday, believers have that opportunity to participate. And it stems again from our understanding. I know there are persons who looked at it at first when we started, there were persons who said, but Rev, every Sunday, because there are persons who, despite the restrictions and so on, still make it to church every Sunday. And at one point we had to say, as often as you do it. So it's not going to take anything away from it. As we like to say, the sacred moment or that particular moment, but that as often as we do it, it strengthens our faith and allows us the opportunity as well to fellowship with each other.
In the churches that tend to have what is regarded as a low view of the sacrament, you would have that sense that to do it often would cheapen the meaning. But in those churches that have a what is regarded as a higher sense of the sacrament, to participate more often deepens rather than dissipates meaning. So I want to say that when we're talking about communion, Holy Communion, and the sacraments, that we're talking about something that is a part of the worship life of the church and is a part of the gift of the church as God's way of being in the world. So the church as the body of Christ, as the sacrament of Christ in the world, celebrates the sacrament as enabling believers to connect in a deep way to God, self-giving, and therefore to our ongoing transformation, the ongoing transformation that is presumed in the liturgy. And what has happened is that persons have tried to find a number of ways to make the adjustment. So they've taken consonance of the health protocols. We must reduce the things we touch. We must reduce the distance between us and so on. And so some churches have gone to where they are using implements to distribute the Holy Communion rather than their hands. The person would come and put their hands in the plate. Instead, they are using like forks and so on to distribute. Others are prepackaging the communion, whether to purchase the prepackaged elements or to prepackage locally under sanitized conditions. And then members are able to come and receive individually, maintaining social distance and with sanitization protocols followed in how the packaging is done and in how they are spaced out. Others, for example, started during the lockdown phase when churches were out to have persons prepare communion elements at home, and to when worship was being done completely virtually, to have persons prepare, experience the consecration of the elements at home and receive at home. And now what they have done since coming back out to worship in the sanctuary, as well as with some persons online, is for persons to bring those sacraments that they prepared at home to the worship space. In that way, there is no breaking of the protocols are regarding sanitization and social distance, because everybody is handling what they have handled in change from home. So a number of ways in which persons have found to get around, so to speak, the challenges with COVID. But we have to face the fact that there are those who raise questions as to whether these ways of getting around it interfere with the theological validity of celebrating it, and that's perhaps where I'd like to hear my colleagues.
Yes, may I just jump in here and ask you to deal with it? Because I've heard of services where people are told you can use anything you have, dumpling, orange juice, fruit juice, biscuit. What do you think about that? Is that taking away from the bread and the wine?
I think it stems from our understanding at the very heart of it, our understanding of what the Lord's Supper is, what it represents, what it means for us as believers. And I think it also has to do with the kind of freedom we have as church, in as much as the Lord's Supper and other such rituals and rites are given to us, gifts from God, they are also mandated in a certain respect, that we still have a certain level of freedom. And I think what COVID has done is that it has opened our eyes to the level of freedom we have, where we are able to do and to participate in the Lord's Supper without the restrictions, for want of a better word, of communion elements and emblems as we have come to know them traditionally. So we have become accustomed to bread and wine, to wafers, to grape juice, to wine. And what COVID has done is that it has allowed us to see that without taking anything away from the intrinsic value of the Lord's Supper, we are still able to participate. We have the freedom to choose, to use whatever elements. Again, this also has to do with our understanding of whether the elements themselves become the body and blood, or are simply symbolic of the body and blood. And if those of us who come down on the side of symbolism would readily accept and agree that the particular element that is used doesn't matter so much as the symbolism behind it. And so crackers, bun, bulla bread, grape juice, orange juice, milk, as you're able to, it represents, what does it represent? The sacrifice God made, Jesus made.
Thanks, and Reverend Salo, final word.
Yes, on one hand though, we have to be careful and look at the meaning of the symbols. For example, the bread representing the body is the staff of life, and Jesus Christ is seen as the word of God, which represents our whole being. And then the wine representing the blood of Christ, you know. So we have to be careful how we choose whatever. So I would say, while I'm not against persons being creative, I like the idea that Reverend Fraser said, that persons brought their own. And in my opinion, when you bring all of those, well, and for me, I would rather you bring your bread and some wine or some grape juice, and then all of those can be blessed, and the service continues. I just think that you have to be careful how you use any and anything. Yeah.
All right, I had said last word, but okay, right. Go ahead.
I'm just saying briefly that staff of life varies with culture. Because I remember, I think it was the BWA that had a program called Jesus, the Bread of Life, but they went into a culture where they had no experience of bread, and Jesus became the rice of life or something like that. So the indigenization of the elements is something that has come up by it. So what would be the bread of life in our situation? We're very familiar with bread, but we're also familiar with cassava, breadfruit. So the element of indigenization, I think, can be held alongside the need to retain that connection with the meaning.
You know, I think we could actually use the entire discussion to deal with the Lord's Supper, but we have to move on to the others. So we're now going to listen to a few more clips, three video clips dealing with baptism and the primary moments.
Greeting everyone. This is Reverend Franz Camille, the pastor for the WhatsApp Circuit of Baptist Churches. In answering to the question that was posed to us, we believe that we can safely say that COVID-19 has really affected the services that the church offers to the community. For example, when one considers weddings, we realize that many persons would have canceled their weddings. We also see that some persons benefit from the fact that COVID has allowed them to have a smaller version of what they have been thinking of having as a wedding. And thirdly, we realize that some persons, they decide to go with RGD because it is way cheaper and easier. When we consider funeral services that the church also offers to the community, many persons in this community love to go to funerals because funeral has always been a family and a community event. They want to be present and participate in the funeral services. However, due to the restrictions of COVID-19, many persons are not able to attend those services and they are not very happy about it. One of the challenges, however, has to do with the fact that when some pastors are trying to help people to observe the protocols, they are not very happy with us. Therefore, we encourage community people and our church members of their responsibilities, ensuring that the spread of the virus stops. We continue as a church to meet with small groups, families, and we also journey with those who are grieving the best way we could. Thank you.
Perhaps the greatest impact of COVID-19 on primary moments in the Salters Hill Circuit of Baptist Churches is in the area of ministry to members who are seriously ill and families who have lost loved ones. The restrictions and regulations implemented to combat COVID-19 have only increased the anxiety, loneliness, and pain that many sick persons and bereaved families have had to endure at times of their greatest need. They have had to do without the sense of solidarity and support, which our physical presence and touch would normally convey during those moments. Burials do not offer the opportunity that gathering for a corporate worship service to remember the deceased would offer the family members, the friends, and communities. Traditionally, those services offer an opportunity for sharing memories, tributes, and moral support. COVID-19 has severely impacted our ability to minister in those conventional ways and for the family to receive the kind of support that is normally extended by the church and the community.
Greetings, everyone. This is our opportunity that we have here just to talk about how, as church, we have been able to respond to the pandemic in light of the particular ministries that we have, but particularly the ordinance of baptism and the practice of dedicating infants. What have we done? We found at the beginning of the pandemic in Jamaica that we had a baptism to do. And guests at that time, because of the uncertainty as to how you deal with baptism and having people in pools and the fact that we had to maintain physical distancing, that we wanted to go through the baptism. So what we did, we had the candidates stand in the middle of the pool and I poured water on their heads. So I was able to keep a little distance, but pour water on their heads, covering them with the water inside the pool. And then they exited and were dried off, reciting the formula. Really, act of dedication of infants, what we have done again, being conscious of the need to maintain physical distancing. I have not held the babies. I have no parents who hold the babies, and I extend to my hand and extend the blessing, offer the blessing at that, in that way. I ask them to hold the child, and then I extend the blessing, and the mother would pass the child to the father after the blessing is expressed. And we have found that just doing the dedication in that way, and also we have not been doing the dedication on a Sunday, primarily because we have allowed more family members to be able to come during the week, like on a Wednesday morning when we have Bible study later, or on a Tuesday when we have midday meditation, and we have the dedication of the infants. And this will take place in the chapel and will be joined by other family members who will not be able to accommodate on a Sunday morning to the limited numbers that we allow to have.
Right, so we were listening then to presentations from Reverend Franz Camille, Worship Circuit in Trelawney, Reverend Shernagay Levy from Salters Hill in St. James, and Reverend Trevor Edwards from Barbican Circuit in St. Andrew. So now we are going to be talking among ourselves here about baptism and then the other, the primary moments. I'm going to start again with Reverend Stacey Lalor Knowles. Baptism. Challenges. How did you deal with them?
Interestingly, I have had one baptismal service since COVID began. It was pretty early in the pandemic, sometime in March. And so all the arrangements had been made for the person. It was just one individual And we took the decision as officers to go ahead with baptism as we usually do, immersion, pastor and candidate in the pool. And that is what we did because we felt, considering it was just one candidate, it wouldn't have posed much of a threat in terms of the spread, you know, keeping with the restrictions. Generally speaking, I have the benefit of being part of a very active minister's fraternal. And even though COVID has impacted us in a number of ways, negatively and positively, we have managed to be able to communicate with each other. And I've found that, as well as interactions with my own Baptist ministerial colleagues, to be very helpful to determine ways forward and to hear how some other persons, some other ministers have been coping. So I have heard a number of stories about persons have had to resort to other creative means, other modes of baptism, aspersion, effusion. One colleague, for example, shared about using a plastic drum and having persons stand in it and the water be poured over and so on. Another spoke of actually immersing, it was a child, and so they had the opportunity to do the immersion, not in the pool, but do the immersion in a vast container. And so, again, I would say what I believe COVID has done for us is that it has allowed the church to find alternate means of expression in terms of these rites and rituals, to step outside of tradition without losing the meaning and the significance of said rituals.
Yes, we have not had any baptism since the COVID. But what I would do say is that the modes of different ways of doing it, I think what the COVID has done, it has allowed persons to see that baptism can be done in different ways. And though we are Baptists and we are used to the immersion, COVID is saying to us, hey, there are other ways that you can do baptism. And I think our people, again, it's a learning curve, but I think our people are getting there.
So immersion, dipping, effusion, pouring, aspersion, sprinkling. And there are many ways in which persons have engaged. So Sister Stacey says that they went into the pool. I don't know if she was wearing mask and face shield at the time, but I've heard of pastors who, one, the speaking that they would normally do in the pool, that is done before social distance. So when they go into the pool, the candidate has on mask, they have on mask, they have on face shield, and it's just the immersion. So to reduce the time and reduce the level of interaction, they go in, everything has been said already, immersed. And of course, as he has indicated, experiences where persons are in the pool and the water is poured on them, as was said on the video. I remember too discussion about the fact that there's a deep unlikelihood that transmission would happen through water, so that there can be reasonable expectation that it would be safe. And I suppose that's because of the high level of chlorine in our regular water sources. So it should be reasonably safe.
And I remember that there are a number of our churches in the country. They have been used to baptizing in rivers and lakes.
And yes, sea.
And sea.
Definitely.
Not so much lakes, but rivers.
The question, though, is when you have a number of persons to be baptized, they maybe have a little challenge if you're going to do the immersion, though they have on the mask. But the fact that more than one person are going to be in the water, I think that will pose a little challenge if you're going to do the immersion.
In some people's mind. And here is where, if persons are comfortable with barrel or other receptacles, if you have 4 or 5 of them, I suppose it would take care of that.
All right, let us now look at funerals. That's one of the problems that Reverend Camille talked about. Can we speak now to that, Reverend Sadler, starting with you?
The modes of baptism?
No, funerals.
The funerals, sorry. Yes, we have had a number of funerals. And what we have done is to go straight to the cemetery. In so we'd go to the cemetery. But what I realize with most persons, they are not satisfied with just like a 15 minutes. They still want to have the hymns and they want to read the lessons. They want to do the eulogy and those stuff. So as a pastor, what I would normally say to them, we have to cut back on some of these things. So instead of reading two lessons, you let them read one. And no amount of tribute. And so you try to cut back on the time, but giving them a sense that their loved one is being treated with a level of respect. So have gone there and have even preached like 5 minute sermons at the graveside. So I think what persons don't want is for you to just rush, take the body into the cemetery and commit it just like that. They want some kind of reassurance, some kind of comforting words for them. And it's difficult. It's difficult because most time the family can't share in the whole thing. Some can't come. And so another thing that happens sometimes is that for the viewing, if you are going to the cemetery, you would maybe say to persons that the viewing will start at, say, 12. So persons can come and view for maybe an half an hour. And then without the gathering, so persons would file in their not one and then view the body. And then they would have more or less leave to go back home. And then the final rites now is where you do the committal and the little service.
Thank you, Reverend Stacey.
I think funerals have always been a signal moment, not just for church, but also for community. And the funeral services are not just a final service for the one departed, but serve as a means of consolation, of closure for all those who would have known the departed. And I think what COVID has done, which is something I regret, is that it has sort of taken away from the kind of level of comfort that we would have been able, that we have become accustomed to being able to share with those, especially of the family that are grieving. What I've found in my own experience, I've had to conduct funerals since COVID began and have heard from other colleagues as well, is that there is, more than anything else, almost a lack of closure that occurs because of how we have been able to. So it's as if persons are not being able to grieve thoroughly, are not being able to be comforted. So, I mean, even just to hold somebody's hand, to give them a pop, those are means by which you would normally have, without even saying a word, been able to minister to someone, to minister to the bereaved. And sadly, COVID has taken that from us. And so you find that persons are now sort of resentful and bitter, almost, when it comes on to how funeral services are being conducted.
And could you just follow on that theme, the grieving and the comforting?
Right. So the challenge is that the practices that we are accustomed to our own funeral really serve as an extended grieving process that is both therapeutic and spiritually enabling for persons as they deal with what is often traumatic. And so in the current situation where what we can do officially is severely restricted. Some churches have been interpreting the protocols creatively to allow for the extension of that. So often there's a separate worship service of memorial conducted with social distance and following the guidelines. And the burial is a separated event, sometimes on a second day or a separate point in the day. And since visiting and the setup and those which are part of the whole experience are minimized, a lot of that is covered electronically.
Okay, thank you. Let's go on to a little bit, well, more happy. Talking about weddings now. Have you had any weddings during that period? Could you just speak briefly for that experience, please? Anyone?
Right, so the main difference there is social distance, so persons are further apart and less contact where perhaps where you would have some practice that would involve touching you. You minimize or eliminate that. And of course, the worshippers, for that aspect of it, would be masked and so on. Of course, the couple wouldn't be masked.
Okay, thanks. Let's go on from there to the next step, please. Infant dedication.
Yes, I've had infant dedication. Very interesting, I heard Reverend Trevor Edwards mention it, not being able to hold the baby. It's kind of, you know, as a pastor, you feel as if something is taken from you, not being able to hold the baby. But nevertheless, what I do is to the parents, the father, especially the father, the last one I did, I asked the father to hold the child up, and then I'll pronounce the blessings. It's kind of what you call the African style, where the child is held very high, and then you pronounce the blessings and all of that. But as I said, it kind of takes something from not being able to hold that child. But keeping protocols, we have to be finding creative ways. And I think that's a very creative way to say to the father or to the mother, hold this child up. We're going to bless this child.
Think Rafi and Lion King.
Oh, he's talking about the Lion
lifting.
King. The
what
lifting.
Is it called?
No, I'm saying the an image of that lifting was in the Lion King series.
Okay, okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Any final word on this whole matter of baptisms and primary moments? Because we're going to go into something else after this.
I would want to say that there are those of us who would lament the impact COVID has had on how we usually do church. But I believe one of the blessings of COVID is that it has allowed us, perhaps in ways that we did not think of before, to be able, and especially as ministers, as teachers of the word, of doctrine, etc. What I've found personally is that it has sharpened my own faith and beliefs and have caused me to want to, again, you know, as it relates to the teaching of our people, of our congregations, to bring to the fore, why do we do these in the first place? Mm-hmm. And so the rituals, the rites, the baptism, the Lord's Supper that we have become so accustomed to doing in a particular way, COVID has created a kind of teaching moment so that we can go back to the why.
That is just a great segue into the next segment, which is hindsight, foresight. Were we prepared? How prepared were we? Did it catch us flat-footed? And then, having learned, what are the best practices that we can recommend going forward? Very briefly, please, each of you. And I want to start with the man in the middle.
To some extent, of course, I would say it. Nobody saw this coming. So to some extent, I would say it caught us flat-footed, but I guess, though, that we were, our response was quick, though, in that we soon find out those persons who didn't know how to get on the social media, the Zoom and the other social platforms, you had to know, be looking into ways on how to get your service across to your members, because, mark you, They still need to hear the word. They still need to be encouraged. And so what COVID does, it brings us into a new era where we, as ministers, we know that, you know, maybe prior to COVID, some of us were reluctant to become technologically savvy. But with COVID, we have to get into the groove. So I think the response caught us a little flat-footed, but the response was kind of quick, where we start to learn how to do things differently.
Right. So I would say logistically, we were unprepared. We this kind of experience that the pandemic brings on is lost to our current memories, over 100 years ago, or around thereabout. But I think in terms of the resiliency of our faith, we were prepared because our faith is so indelible, so thick. We were able to make the adjustment and even doing things virtually because the patterns and the rhythms are inbuilt into our consciousness, even into a muscle memory. We can still experience from a distance and find meaning and connection. So what is crucial is we used to express a lot of the sense of presence, God's presence to us, our presence to each other, to true touch. But we are adjusting that for the time being to experience that sense of presence without it, but to have that still be meaningful for our sense of faith. And as Sister Stacey says, probably even strengthening our faith.
Reverend Stacey, going forward, best practices?
Well, I wanted to touch on the hindsight first, just to say three R words come to my mind. Resourcefulness, resilience, and relationship. And I believe because we as a church, as the church, we have always had the resources that we need. That's God's gift to us. There is no church, no congregation that is without the resources it needs. What this crisis has done is that it has provided the opportunity for more persons to make themselves available as resources. It has strengthened in many respects the relationships that we share, not just with each other, but also with God. And resilience, as Rev mentioned, it has taught us that even though we might have been caught off guard, as the church, we always have the capacity to bounce back and to respond to the realities of the time in which we live. Going forward, it has taught us, I suppose, the same lessons. We have what we need, that we're always going to be faced with challenges over time, changes, adapting. That's part of the nature of being church, of being together, serving together, growing together. And going forward, I think perhaps one of the main lessons is that we would have learned, as it relates to ministry, to not rule anything out. That even the things that we might have considered prior to COVID as not being able to be used as part of the ministry, or even persons who have not been able to be used as part of our ministry, that we have learned now how to be a little bit more inclusive, a little bit more open-minded.
And using technology, I saw you looking at your phone. Did you get any WhatsApp questions?
Yes, we have two questions. I guess we'll take them one at a time.
Please go ahead.
The first says, while the bread and wine have specific meanings as used in the Lord's Supper, how helpful or harmful could it be to explore the expressions of the presence of God in our world through various symbols that may be identified for use in communion?
I thought we'd kind of dealt with that. But Reverend Sadler, you want to give one word on that?
We did.
I think my stance on it, as I had said that I had no problem sticking to the bread and the wine. But then my colleagues had said, well, bread, the staff of life is not just bread as we know it. It's food, and there are other things in other culture, and even in our own culture, that represent, that are really staff of life. And so...
just bread as metaphor, not just...
Yes, right.
Bread as...
it's not just bread as we know it.
Not literally.
Yes.
And the next?
The second question. One significant part of rites and rituals is that of ministry to the community. Much of what is missed is the public participation. How can the church help members of the community learn to develop new patterns of coping with life, such as grieving for funerals, celebrations for dedications and weddings, etc.?
Well, since you have read such a long question, would you please respond?
Well, can I respond?
Sure, I'll yield.
One of the things in terms of the community, and as we were saying earlier on, it because of the brief, how brief our funerals have to be, and persons are not sensing that that closure. One of the things that I think that we should do, whenever this COVID is over, I think most of our churches should look at having a memorial service where they can remember those persons in a more meaningful way and get the community and family to be more involved in it. So I think a memorial service of magnitude would assist in that area. And I also want to say going forward that the COVID has taught us many lessons, one of which I want to embrace, and is that our primary moments like funeral and weddings, we recognize that these moments do not have to be so elaborate. And so a lot of persons have cut costs, so I think going forward, we should not let that go.
That is a great point. Well, that now brings us to the end of this panel discussion. And I just want to thank all of our participants or panelists for this wonderful discussion. I want to thank you, our brethren, for viewing this discussion. And I hope that you will come again next week when we're going to be having panel 3. We look forward to seeing you next week, and we pray God's richest blessings on you till then.
From the healing of your body to the raising of the dead. Church say,
amen.